Welcome back to the second part of the presentation dealing with technological modelling. In this podcast, we're going to review some aspects of technological modelling, look at the link between the knowledge and practice and some teaching strategies, and then look at the related NCEA assessments in levels 1 to 3 in NCEA. But before we begin, what do you know or remember about technological modelling? Just pause and reflect on these questions as they form the basis of progression through to level 8 of the curriculum. So just take a moment now and reflect on these. What do you remember? So let's review then technological modelling. So it's both functional modelling and prototyping. Functional modelling is a tool that allows us to carry out ongoing testing and communication of our design concepts and design ideas and test our design decision making through the development of our technological outcomes. Testing from design ideas to conceptual design allows us to predict the probability that this design or these ideas have the potential to be fit for purpose. It also allows students to justify their decision making within their practice. Is it going to function? Will it be acceptable? So therefore making some informed predictions of the possible and probable consequences of their proposed designs and outcomes. Functional modelling is also referred to as testing, trialling or predictive modelling. In textiles, we might make a toile or a mock-up. In resistant materials, we might make some scale models or some test joints or use 2D and 3D CAD sketching. In foods, we might use some preference testing and taste testing. It could be in digital technologies, a range of things from circuit diagrams to storyboards. And in all areas, we probably all use surveys and targeted stakeholder feedback. To test these design concepts, as well as the complete conceptual design, is really important so that we get a full picture of the physical and functional nature of the outcome as required by the brief. Students should be exploring and evaluating their concepts from the range of perspectives so they can defend what their decision making may look like. And they explore the technical feasibility, is it possible to do this, and the social acceptability, is it okay to do this, while identifying and managing risks. So it does provide the opportunity to reduce waste of resources, encourage and enable environmentally sensitive and potentially sustainable developments, and it looks at increasing confidence that the fully realised technological outcome will actually do the job it's intended to, resulting in fewer unknown or undesirable impacts. It also allows students and technologists to make informed decision making around risk identification and management and explore those big ideas of competing and contestable factors. We'll come back to those particular concepts later in the podcast. So, prototyping. What is it? What does it do? Generally, prototyping allows for evaluating the fitness for purpose of the outcome. It's generally in a school setting, the one-off outcome, and it's tested and evaluated in situ, which was really important. So in many instances, if we align this to what happens in the real world, it leads to the acceptance or refinement, and in the real world, often rejection and a new plan starts, or significant modifications. Students need to really understand how to evaluate in terms of fitness for purpose to make decisions and judgments around their prototype. So the importance of the prototype in developing an outcome is that we evaluate its fitness for purpose against the brief. So again, it goes back to the need or opportunity, the context and the issue. So students need in the higher levels of the curriculum to be able to go backwards and forwards from their modelling to the brief, to the context and the issue, to make sure that the decision making they're undertaking actually does give an outcome that is fit for purpose. So they're using evidence and information to evaluate and to make informed and defensible decision making. Technological modelling is used to inform decisions around risk management. So it identifies possible risks and it also involves making decisions around whether to avoid, mitigate, transfer or manage that risk. So what's the probability? What's the likelihood? And this doesn't have to be huge probability calculations, but talking about what is likely to go wrong and how do we actually manage that environment. Technological modelling asks students to use two types of reasoning, both functional and practical, to ensure that they're looking at the potential and actual impact of the outcome in terms of its fitness for purpose. So they're looking at technical feasibility and its social acceptability within the social and physical environments. So they have to consider where it's going to be situated and what's the impact, who's going to be affected by that. So that's the social side of looking at the environment. So it does mean that students use reasoning to explore things around moral, ethical, social, political, economic, and environmental dimensions in their decision making. So that we're actually widening their horizons as we're moving through the levels of technological modelling towards level 8 of the curriculum. So let's begin at level 6 of the curriculum. The achievement objective is around understanding the role and nature of evidence in reasoning when managing risk in modelling. So students would need to understand what is modelling before they actually undertake level 6. They need to understand different types of modelling, what we find out from different types of modelling, who uses different types of information and at what stage, and how does it help us to manage risk. So you need to, as a teacher, guide the students around understanding these concepts as outlined on this slide and support them to analyse some examples so that they understand risk and identify those sorts of things within a technological development in order to be able to do that in their own practice. Examples should be looking at wider current events around issues that the students will connect with in terms of the discipline area you work within. So successful students will be able to describe the decision making and discuss the way the decision making actually allows the outcome to be fit for purpose. So they'll explain the modelling, they'll look at identification of risk, they'll discuss examples around how evidence and reasoning is used, and they'll look at how prototyping provided information to determine maintenance requirements to ensure minimal risk and optimal performance over time. So what's the impact over time of this particular outcome? Assessment is quite specific. Says here's the criteria at level 6 NCEA level 1, where students have to identify the modelling undertaken, they have to identify the evidence and describe how the evidence informed decisions about the could and should, i.e. technical feasibility and social acceptability. And then it steps up to looking at that through an explained mode and then discussing. So students, in terms of literacy, they will need to be able to differentiate between identification, explanation, and discussion. So some strategies that may help you do this is to turn the criteria into questions. Work with the students to actually turn those criteria into a question that helps scaffold them a report format that they can collect evidence to as they go through using modelling throughout the year. So they could use the following questions to guide them. What was the modelling done? What did I do? And what did I find out? What was the evidence? What decisions did I make? Therefore, you know, it's the what, so what, now what scenario. How did this help me manage the risk? But first, of course, they have to identify what the risks are. The assessment specifications are really specific for 2013 in terms of level one. They need to provide evidence that can come from one or more technological outcomes, so it would be sensible to start this assessment early and gather information as they're working through their technological developments across the year. They need to consider risk, they need to consider their decision making, and they need to actually talk about what they have actually done to consider evidence from real modelling processes used to make actual decisions. It's very clear in the specs that students who produce reports without close reference to their experience of modelling are unlikely to succeed. So in terms of literacy, students will need to be able to understand what prototyping is, what functional modelling is, what the nature of risk and probability is around their outcome, the technical feasibility and social acceptability, and as I mentioned earlier, be able to describe, explain and discuss. The specs at level 2 and 3 are not specifically tied to practice, but as with level 1, material should clearly communicate understanding, so annotated photographic evidence, annotated illustrations, written descriptions and explanations. Where it comes from outside the student practice, it's really key that the student must use their own voice. So this leads us to authenticity. So paraphrasing can help interpreting the information, using information in various ways, relating the information to their own practice, and commenting meaningfully on information that they gather. Inline referencing is preferred, so make sure that sources that are not from this candidate's own work must be acknowledged very clearly so that the examiners can see what the student has done, where the information has come from, and make a judgment on whether this is actual student work or not. Level 7, should and could decisions around technological modelling and how evidence changes across contexts. If you find that should and could confuses your students, try substituting the should with social acceptability and technical feasibility. It may help them just come grapple with that in terms of functional modelling. So teaching and learning section of the indicators of progression outlines what you do to support and guide your students. So here we see we're stepping back a little bit further. Most of the teaching is about supporting students to understand valid evidence, how it's been used to ascertain and mitigate risk, getting students to support them to analyse some examples. And again, really need to choose examples where the students can see modelling, where modelling was undertaken to manage risk factors. So, if they're successful, students can discuss examples to illustrate the nature of evidence and why it might change from place to place or group to group, why different people accept different types of evidence, whether that be credible evidence or opinion-related preferential testing, explaining the role of modelling in ascertaining and mitigating these risks, and then describing examples so that we can see that students definitely understand that change to actually probability and risk management. Again, try and use the criteria to support students to understand the nature of the report they're writing and how they can actually use that to gather information from various sources. At level 8, we actually start looking far more at wider concepts. So we start looking at moral, ethical, sustainable, cultural, political, economic, and historical grounds. And this raises a really important factor that we support our students to critically analyse examples to identify competing and contestable factors to gain insight into how those factors are managed within a technological development. So again, choosing case studies wisely is really important. Successful students can explain the role of modelling in informed, responsive and defensible decision making, so they can defend. Responsive as in changing direction during what they're doing, not responsible as I've seen some people write, but responsive. So they actually undertake modelling and they respond to that in an appropriate way. So again, we're actually students to really step up to looking at informed, responsive, defensible manufacturing decisions as well. So those competing and contestable factors. Competing, things that actually vie for a place. So renewable versus non-renewable resources is a really good way of explaining that. Kids will get competing factors quite easily because it's something they manage all the time, budget versus materials. Contestable is around accommodating different points of view and how different people and different groups actually will challenge decision making based on that point of view. So here are some examples: time versus quality, innovation versus continuation or acceptance, differing stakeholder points of view. From the exemplars, here's a really good example of how a student has talked about what they're actually doing within their own practice around competing and contestable. And finally, a quick look there. Here are the achievement criteria. Again, it's explain, up to discuss, and looking at those competing and contestable factors. So this is just a snapshot of that progression through from level 6 to 8 of the curriculum and also levels 1 to 3 of the assessment resources. Ka kite anō. I look forward to speaking with you again in the not too distant future.